All right, good morning, everyone. Come on in and find a spot. Good to see all of you. It's been a busy morning already. Please take note of our special Christmas weekend. So that's Christmas Eve, Saturday night. That service will be the exact same as Christmas Sunday morning. And so if you're having an effect because of all that, don't worry. That's fine. Please take note about Christmas Eve, Saturday night, and the same things anymore. So make plans about what you and your family will do. As we try to accommodate people for the Saturday night Christmas Eve service, my family is going to skip that and show up Sunday morning. So just be mindful. You make plans about what you want to do with your family, the exact same service, Christmas Eve, Saturday night, and Christmas Day the following Sunday morning. So we've come to worship the Lord, and one of the huge barriers to worship is our own sin. And oftentimes we feel like the way to get past that barrier is just by promising God that we will do better next time. And if you have come into the room this morning with those similar feelings, feeling a weight of your own sinfulness and a need to make it right by promising to do better next time, can I read you some good news? It's in Romans chapter 3. Beginning in verse 21. And so if you want to follow along in your own Bible, you may. If not, we're going to put it on screen for you. There are some really big words in this passage, but the gist of it is that God gives us His own righteousness, His own goodness. God gives us His own clean slate because of Christ and the Lord Jesus' death. And so that's a lot of what we're celebrating here in Christmas time, is the reason Jesus came and what it means for us. So let me read for you from Romans chapter 3, just to kind of set your mind and the tone for our worship service this morning. The scripture reads, "But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it." So the Old Testament part of the Bible points to the God's grace. "The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Because there is no distinction, because all have sinned," you're not alone, "and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by His grace as a gift," that is a great Christmas present, "as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood." That big word just means that it removed all of the punishment and wrath for our sin. "And this is received by faith," simply trusting in Christ. "This was to show God's righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over our former sins, and it was to show His righteousness at this present time, so that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. And so what then becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By the law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is He not the God of the Gentiles also? Yes, of the Gentiles," it's you and I, "of the Gentiles also, since God is one, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law." God has made a tremendous way for sinners like you and I to stand guilt-free in His presence. So no matter what you're feeling this morning, I invite you to consider Christ, and that He has died for our sins. And if you've known that and have already received that, then stand with me. Why don't you all stand with me, and let us sing of God's grace together.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born. Humbly he lay, Creator came as creature, born on the floor of a hay-scattered straw. True Son of God, yet bearing human feature, he entered earth to reverse Adam's fall. In towering grace, he laid aside his glory, and in our place, his sacrifice for sin. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the gospel story, oh, night divine. Come then to him who lies within a manger, with joyful shepherds proclaim him as Lord. Let not the promised son remain a stranger, in reverent worship make Christ your adore. Eternal life is theirs who would receive him with grace and peace. Their lives he will adorn. Fall on your knees. Receive the gospel of heaven. Oh, night divine.
Father, we thank you for Jesus and setting aside this morning for us to relish in the fullness of what you've done through him. And so as we hear the gospel story over and over, Lord, I pray that you would begin to work on our hearts in such a way that we would worship, not just in this room, but throughout the week. So come, we ask, and in these moments continue to press these glorious truths deeper into our souls. We ask in Christ's name, amen. Please be seated. This morning, if you have a Bible, would you turn with me, please, to the Gospel of Luke? We've been working our way through Luke this holiday season. Season of Advent, these Sundays surrounding the birth of our Savior. And this morning, we want to continue Luke chapter 1. We've been looking at the songs recorded in the Gospel of Luke. Mary's song this morning, Zechariah's song, the angel's song next week, Simeon's song. We hope that as we look at the songs that surrounded the first Christmas, we would learn what it would mean to sing at the holidays from our hearts again. For some of us, the holidays brings on tremendous sadness as memories come and regrets come and loss comes back. But I'm hoping that no matter who you are and no matter what you've experienced, that these few weeks, as we travel through these first Christmas songs, would stir our hearts to sing again for the glory of Christ. So this morning we begin in Luke chapter 1, verse 57, and we will see what many have called the Benedictus, Zechariah's song. And so let me just read for you, and to set the stage, kind of set the tone, let me remind you that the key guy that we will read of today, a father by the name of Zacharias, should not be a father. He is too old for him and his wife Elizabeth to have just given birth to their first son. This is truly a miracle. And all the things that are happening in these days are pointing to Christ, the one who is soon to come after this baby. And all that is happening here, all the miracles that are surrounding here, are all pointing to the wonder of this season. So this man, Zechariah, because of his unbelief, something that many of us share in common with him, the Word of God comes and we simply will not believe it. Because of his unbelief, he has been unable to speak for 9 months. And we pick up in this passage, right here in verse 57, the time came for Elizabeth, his wife, to give birth. And she bore a son, verse 58. And her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they would have called him Zechariah, after his father. But his mother answered, "No, he will be called John." And they said to her, "None of your relatives is called by this name." And they made signs to his dad, his father, inquiring what he wanted him to be called. And he asked for a writing tablet, and he wrote, "His name is John." And they all wondered. And immediately his mouth was opened, and his tongue was loosed, and he spoke, blessing God. And fear came on all the neighbors, and all these things were talked about through the hill country of Judea. And all who heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, "What then will this child be? For the hand of the Lord was on him." And his father, Zechariah, filled with the Holy Spirit, prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people. And he has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and at the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace." And the child grew and became strong in spirit. And he was in the wilderness until the day of his public appearance to Israel. This is the word of the Lord, and it is wonderful. Would you pray with me? Father, with so much spinning through our minds, we ask for a settled peace and the ability to concentrate on your word. We don't just ask it for our joy, although that is something we long for. We ask it because we know that as we give due heed to your word and come underneath the sway of its teaching and bend our will and hearts into more conformity with what you reveal, we know that you are glorified as we put our trust in you and as you become our joy and our song. So I am asking that you would do for us, as scary as it might seem, something similar as what you did for Zechariah. And so drive the wonder of your grace to the depths of our souls, that when our mouths open, they will open blessing you, not moaning about our situation. So, we ask that you would do more than we are capable of doing and more than we can ask or imagine. And we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. The text before us is a wonderful text. It breaks down very easily. So this morning we're going to talk about the fact that this text is pointing to a whole other child, not Zechariah's child. It's pointing to the Christ. And the text unpacks for us more. It puts back in more pieces of the puzzle so we could see the picture of what's the purpose of this Christ child to come, the one that we put up trees and sing songs about. What's the purpose? And as you look into the text, you can see it. You can see that's laid out before us a scene and a song. The scene and the song all pointing to the wonder of this Christ child. And the lesson, one of the big lessons I took away from just studying Zechariah and the Lord's dealing with this father, it reminded me of a passage I read in a book called Blue Like Jazz by Donald Miller. I don't completely recommend all the parts of this book. You should read it with care and caution. But there is a part where the writer, Don, was standing in line at the grocery store, and there was a lady in front of him being checked out by the lady at the register. And when it came time to pay, she pulled out of her purse what Donald Miller called the bright currency of poverty. She used food stamps to pay for her groceries. Now, if that's the solution that some of you, the situation you're in where you're dependent on the government to provide for your health care or provide for your food, that is wonderful. That's fine. That's the situation God has you in, and he's providing for your needs. For Don, standing behind this lady in line, it jolted him. It was unexpected because back then, the documents that you would hand the cashier weren't the normal green color of money. They were bright colors. Like, why would you do that? Why would you highlight someone's need? And so everyone felt weird. The lady felt weird. The cashier felt weird. Don standing behind her felt weird. And there rose up in him a desire to pull out his wallet, put down a credit card, and pay for her meal. And he realized, oh, that's not helping. Because I'm just underlining the lack of dignity that she feels. We are making this worse by all shuffling around on our feet. And so with downcast eyes, the cashier filled out the paperwork, filed the lady through, got her bags, and ushered her out. Later that night in his community group, they were taking prayer requests. And as person after person shared, the group leader asked Don, what can we pray for? What's going on in your life? And he said, I have no needs. That's fine. We'll just pray for other people. And his friend, the group leader, looked at him and said, Don, you are not beyond the grace of God. you are not beyond the grace of God. I don't care how long you've been in church. I don't care how much Bible knowledge you've got stacked in your head. I don't care if you're a pastor. You are not beyond the need for the grace of God. And then Don said, it hit him. That morning in the grocery line came back and he realized what it would feel like for him to finally realize that he wasn't the person in need of someone else to pay his way and provide for his needs. Because he realized again that he was spiritually bankrupt. A very similar feeling to the priest Zechariah, who was just in service in the temple earlier in chapter 1, who had the awesome responsibility by lot, randomly chosen, to serve at the altar of incense near the temple of God. Zechariah has had huge privileges. He's advanced in years. He's got a track record of what the scripture calls blameless before God. He is a man who knows his Bible very, very well, as we hear about in the song he's about to sing. And yet, God, in mercy to Zechariah, shut him up for 9 months. You refuse to believe my word, therefore, Zechariah, you will have no words. More than that, our text indicates not only could he not speak, he was unable to hear. We'll get to that in just a minute. So he was trapped in utter silence for 9 months, unable to hide from his friends, from his neighbors, from his relatives, his unbelief. And all that God did in his life to remind him, Zechariah, you are not beyond the need for God's grace in your life. You are not so advanced, Pastor Zechariah, that you cannot learn from the Almighty. You are not so far along in your church life, Zechariah, that you do not need to keep yourself humble before your God and Redeemer. And so, I, as one of your pastors, this was driven home to me this week. My own personal ongoing need for God's grace in my life. Undeserved, unearned, nothing I could do to come face to face again with the fact that except for this Christ child, I, like you, am in absolute poverty spiritually. By the way, that's the kind of poverty that matters most. Every other kind of poverty is just pointers. We stand in absolute spiritual need of God's grace, and we will never get beyond that. So this morning, let me just unpack a few things for you as we press on. Let's look at the first block of verses, the scene that is laid out before us, beginning in verse 57. In verse 57, like I said, the time had come for Elizabeth, Zechariah's wife, to give birth to her son. This is not baby Jesus. This is his older cousin, second cousin. This is a famous John the Baptist that you may have heard about if you're familiar with your Bible. When he was born, 9 months have passed. Zechariah has picked up, even though he's not been able to hear, he's picked up on conversation that his wife Elizabeth has had with their younger cousin, who's 12, 13, 14, 15, who is a virgin, who is also with child. By whatever means of sign language or communication, he has had to steep on the fact that even though his wife and his young cousin were quick to believe the word of God, he, a priest in God's temple, was slow to believe. Are you that way this morning? Maybe you have family members who belief comes easy for them. It comes quickly for them. They hear the word of the Lord and they dive into it with both feet. And you stand back in cynicism and skepticism and you are slow to believe all that God has revealed. Primarily about the Christ child. Have you had a season in life where God has put you on your back in a hospital bed or a sick bed or out of work for a while, and you are forced to come to terms with the big issues in your life? So often, our lives function as autopilots on an aircraft, keeping us level, keeping us from dipping too far down or getting too high. As cruise control on our cars, keeping us from going too fast or too slow. Not too fast that life becomes dangerous. We've got to think about big things. Not too slow that life slows down. We've got to give thought to big things. We just stay calm, entertained at a nice cruising altitude and cruising speed. Zechariah was slowed down by the disciplining hand of God. And brothers and sisters, you and I have and will continue to experience God's fatherly discipline in our lives. And one of the keys is what you'll be like when it's done. Will you come to the other side bemoaning God or blessing God? What words will come out of your mouth when your hour of discipline is over? Zechariah says, our text goes on, that when the son was finally born, apparently Zechariah could still not speak after 9 months. So, verse 58. And her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown great mercy. I love that phrase. Great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, as was the custom, they came to circumcise the child. So there's a big party. Everybody's hanging around. This is a week plus later. On the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child. This is a sign of the old covenant. And at that time, that's when you name your child. And they would have named him Zach Jr. They would have given him his father's name, Zechariah. That is a custom of the time. That's exactly what should have been done by just a norm of that time. Verse 60. But mom spoke up because dad couldn't. Mom spoke up and emphatic in the original, no. Sorry, I'll try to be better. No. No. He shall be called John. A common enough name. Lots of people you know are named John. Lots of people back here in this time are named John. Super common name, but it doesn't fit the culture. The cultural norm is, watch. And they said to her, verse 61, Elizabeth, nobody in your family has that name. And they made signs to his father. They played charades with his dad, inquiring what name he wanted him to be called. So if mom is unreasonable, let's turn our attention to dad. This is a lot of reason why young parents don't tell you the name of their children to be born until it's too late. Because nobody wants all the community chiming in going, that is a dumb name. What? Well, his whole life he's going to be called by that name. In the book I told you about, Blue Like Jazz, Donald Miller has a friend whose parents were hippies in the Pacific Northwest. And she was born on a hippie commune, and her mom named her Plenty. Plenty. She said that she changed her name to Penny as soon as she realized she was allowed to do so. So, here in verse 62, after they made signs to his father, figuring out, okay, maybe dad's more reasonable than mom, he asked for a writing tablet, like a piece of wood with wax on it so he could kind of scratch into it with a stylus. He asked for a writing tablet, and he wrote, now, in English, this is really good English, and there's no big mystery here, but bear with me. He wrote, his name is John. Literally, he wrote the name first. John is his name. Emphatic. Not, hey, you know, we were thinking about John. What do you guys think about that? There is no wishy-washiness to Zechariah now. His time of unbelief is over. And he has learned his lesson. And watch now. And they all wondered Verse 64, and immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue was loose and he spoke, blessing God. He has come full circle. And fear came on all their neighbors, and all these things were talked about through all the hill country of Judea, and all who heard it laid them up in their hearts. That's a really important phrase in the Gospel of Luke. Mary will do that several times as she watches her son, as she watches as God works through the birth of her son, different scenes in his life, his crucifixion. Mary will lay these things up in her heart. And now the entire region is laying these things up in their hearts. And they ask the exact right question, what then will this child be? Because the hand of the Lord was with him. That is super important. So let me just highlight a few things for you. Now, the reason Luke wrote all of this, Luke tells us in verse 4, is I'm writing these things so that you, my readers, would be really, really certain about all the stuff you've heard about. So like Theophilus, you too have heard the gospel. You've heard the story of the Christ child. You've heard this all before. But somehow, our hearts aren't in it. Somehow we feel like we've moved past this knowledge, and it's not ringing in our souls the way it should. Luke writes so that Theophilus and we, his readers, would have what he calls more certainty about the things we have been taught. Not just so that we would know it concretely, intellectually, but that it would ring deep within us. That word know comes up over and over in our passage, and I don't have time to unpack it for you. Here's what I will unpack for you. One of the reasons why this passage is given to booster our faith, our confidence in these things, is that names indicate authority. In the Bible, more is at stake than just your favorite name. Names indicate authority. We did this a few weeks ago. Back in Genesis, Adam is made by God and given the task of naming the animals. Scientifically naming, classifying the animals, Adam, your job is to name them. And whatever name you give them, Adam, that's their name. I'm not arguing with this. So God delegates authority to Adam and says, name them all. God brings his wife to Adam and her task, and his task is to name his wife. Here in this passage, it is given to parents the authority to name their kids. And I won't unpack them all for you, but Elizabeth means something. Zacharias means something. John means something. Jesus means he will save his people from their sins. All of these names mean something. John means grace. It's a pointer to God's grace. But the big point in all of this is that for this child, God himself reserves the right to name this kid. That's massive. That means that the people at the end of this passage ask the exact right question. What then is this child going to be? They don't ask, who is he? They will ask that of Jesus. Of Jesus, throughout the Gospel of Luke, they will ask, who is this guy? Of John, they will ask, what then shall this child be? What will he be? They have never seen anything like this before. They've never heard of anything like this before. The last time God came and gave a child to a barren couple, well advanced in years, was Abraham and Sarah. And that started a whole new work of God, calling people out of obscurity into relationship with himself. All of these Israelites are children of Abraham. And so the big question is, what then will come from this child? What will come from these happenings? Isaac came to be and was the son of the promise. Big things happen through the line of Isaac. What will happen through this child, John? That's exactly the right question. And Zechariah himself goes on to answer it in the next phrase. But before we get there, let me just stop for just a minute to ask you to think about that a long silence was broken. As we said last week, God waited hundreds of years, 450 years, to speak to his people again because of their constant cycle of rebellion, and then going into exile or being overrun by an enemy nation, and then coming back to repentance and God restoring them. So rebellion and exile, repentance and restoration, a long history back and forth. As a matter of fact, it's amazing to me that Zechariah didn't pick up on that when he was being informed by the angel of what would happen. He asks the question, how can this be? I am too advanced in years, and this can't happen. My wife is too advanced in years. We cannot have a son. A priest who knows his Bible well should have realized there was a crucial moment in the lives of God's people when they were at the borders of the promised land, faced with an impossible task, and God said, go. The cities are already built. I've got houses already built for you. The vineyards are already cultivated. The farmland is already done. It's all done for you. The property is already settled. The land flowing with milk and honey. It's all yours. Gift to you. I've done it all for you. And they said, no. We are too small. We are too weak. With eyes focused on themselves, they said, no. And it was called unbelief. And for that, none of them could enter. That entire generation died in the desert. Zechariah knows that for his bold-faced unbelief to an angel of God in the temple. Just FYI, I'm slow, but I'm not that slow. Like, if an angel comes to you at church while you're praying, I'm just saying, like, even I would get that one. Or would we? Or would we? I mean, who do we think we are? Zechariah knows the story. He knows why the people didn't enter. And wonder of wonders, instead of striking him dead, the angel strikes him silent. So when it's finally all done and he walks in obedience and names the child, he comes out blessing God, not cursing God. So here's Zechariah didn't go looking for silence, but maybe we should. John Piper writes, if we don't seek out silence, we will probably not feel the stupendous significance of God's work in history on our lives. It would be a rare thing to be gripped and moved deeply in a noisy room. There is a close correlation between stillness and a sense of the stupendous. And so, in awe and wonder and fear of all that's happened, the people ask the right question, what will this child be? And dad takes up a song. The dude starts to sing. I like guys when they sing. That's a good thing. So if you're a guy in the room, we're singing songs, sing out. The father takes up a song and he sings these words, beginning in verse 67. And his father, Zechariah, filled with the Holy Spirit. Now just watch the Holy Spirit over and over in these passages. And prophesied, saying, blessed be God. Now, the title for this song comes from that opening word, blessed be the Lord God, Benedictus. So I'm just going to, being a closet musician, I'm just going to break down the song for you. So that if you want to study this on your own, we're going to put this on the internet, you can study this passage on your own. I have broken down this song into two parts and two verses and a chorus. Verse 1, starting verse 69 through 75, is about God. Really, the whole thing's about God, but still. God, and what's particular about God? That God is a promise-keeping God. That is massive. And you really need to swallow that and help yourself with your cynicism. God is a promise-keeping God. And number 2, a verse about John, beginning in verse 76, that John's part in this story, this baby's part in this story, is to run ahead of the coming Christ, the coming Lord himself. And remarkably, the chorus that is repeated twice in the song, at the beginning and at the end, the thing that you are left ringing in your ears is a chorus of Advent. that God has visited us. He's arrived in time to rescue. Verses 68 through 69 and 78 through 79. And now I just want you to see it. The chorus, the repeated line, is the word visit. Bookending this song, starting, ending, or if you don't like music, fine. Maybe you like a sandwich. So think of this passage as like a scripture sandwich. And the bread of visitation on both ends helps to give significance to the meat in the middle. In the Bible, this phrase, visit, is a phrase pregnant with meaning. When you would hear it, it's such a rare thing that when you would hear it, your mind would instantly go back to Egypt when for 400 plus years of slavery in Egypt, God heard the prayers and cries of his people and visited them in the deliverer, Moses, Exodus chapter 4. Using the same exact word translated, visit. God has visited his people through sending the deliverer, Moses and Aaron. This phrase comes up in Luke chapter 7, speaking of the Lord Jesus. When people stand in awe and wonder about what kind of person this would be, this is God visiting his people. This is picked up again in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 2, where God visits us in salvation. So let me just lean into the bread ends there and help kind of with the meat in the middle. The first visitation, verse 68 into verse 69, is that God has blessed be the Lord God of Israel, verse 68, for he has visited and redeemed his people. Notice again, Zechariah is speaking in the past tense as if it's already happened. It's as good as done. The bringing about of these miraculous babies and all these weird circumstances shows that God is doing something incredible, and it's as good as done. God has visited his people and has redeemed his people. How has he done so? He has done so, verse 69, by raising up, he has raised up a horn of salvation for us. Now, these are Jewish people. You are probably not Jewish. However, you and I, Gentiles, find a place in this text. The horn of salvation is coming, as he will talk about later, in fulfillment to the promises he made to Abraham, that God made to Abraham, verse 73. And part of those promises is that this coming one, this one who would fulfill God's promises to Abraham, would make him the father of many nations. And that through this coming one, Abraham would be a blessing to all the families on the earth. This would spread past his family and encompass people from every family. This is a horn of salvation. Now, that is a weird image for us. We're not used to that. Maybe you're used to it. I'm not. I'm primarily a city kid. But when we moved to Louisiana, we had our good friends back there that introduced us to 4-H stuff. So maybe you are really familiar with 4-H stuff. Maybe it's a big part of your life. The state fair, all the stuff that happens in 4-H life, I think it's awesome. I think it's a huge, wonderful world that I'm just kind of scratching the surface of. Oxen, like by calling it a horn of salvation, he's not thinking of a musical horn. That's exactly where my mind went, is a musical horn. That's not what he's thinking about. He's talking about like an ox horn, this huge animal that stands as tall as us, as our heads, who's just got a huge head in itself. And when it's reached full maturity, has two huge horns that come out of its head. And any other animal that sees an ox knows to fear. If you see an ox with its huge horns, you know this is a powerful beast. And this animal with his strong, pointy horns can even spear a lion. So the imagery is one of absolute strength. The imagery is one of absolute strength for salvation. I can't help it. I thought of it as a modern tractor pull. I thought of it as different farmers bringing out their tractor, just who's got the strongest tractor. Let me load it up and see what an ox was the equivalent back then of your best, I'm going to pick a side, John Deere. I just divided the room in half. Love you, Mike. So pick your tractor. This is God's tractor. It's the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is going to win the day. That's the strength behind the horn of salvation. When this animal steps on the horizon, other animals see his strength and fear. When he talks about, in verse 68, that this is in line with the house of David, this is not talking about his son, John. Zechariah is not talking about his baby. He's talking about the other baby that's to come, the one who's in the line of David the king. When he speaks of saving from our enemies, verse 71, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy, the mercy he promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham. All of this is speaking of the strength to what he says in verse 74, to serve him without fear. That is the reason for this salvation. The reason for all of this show of strength in the coming of Christ is that we might serve God without fear. That is an incredible thing. And to do so in holiness and righteousness before him all of our days. Notice with me that it is a service without fear, fear of other enemies, fear of Rome at this time, I'm sure, but also in such a way that we are holy and righteous before him all our days. Do you ever get frustrated at yourself because you keep bouncing back and forth between rebellion and repentance? Rebellion and repentance. When you read the Old Testament and you see the Israel nation give up on God, turn to the culture around them, and then get punished for it and come back in repentance, do you not wail as you see your own soul reflected there and wish for a day that your own rebellion will be put past you and you would be free to serve God all of your days in holiness and without fear? It is a beautiful thing being spoken of here, and it is coming. Because amidst all these other enemies, like the Roman Empire, even Zechariah will talk about a kind of spiritual enemy, a real enemy. Peter says that our enemy, the devil, is like a roaring lion, and he prowls around seeking someone to devour. The enemy is always on the hunt, trying to find ways to mess with God's people and sink us into unbelief. And yet, there is one who has come who is like an ox. And the Lord Jesus stands in his might and strength and skewers the satanic lion and ultimately triumphs over him so that we will be able to serve him in all of our days to come without fear and in holiness and in righteousness. This child who is to come, the Lord who is to come, will do these things. And if you ask me, if you say, Dean, this has been 2,000 years since the Christ child was born, and when will these things be? When will this start to happen? Zechariah says, this has already begun to happen. Notice the way he says it. He says in verse 67, he turns to the second part, and he talks about his own son. And you, child, will be called prophet of the Most High. And you will go before the Lord. So the child who is to come after you is the Lord. You're to go before him to prepare his ways. What are you going to do? You're to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins. And this is totally me looking at the wider picture here. When he said that, I wonder if he was thinking of the past 9 months that he had to think about his own sin of unbelief and not being crushed by God, but being restored. finding at the hand of the Almighty not punishment for the sins he has committed, especially the sin of unbelief, but, verse 77, forgiveness of their sins. And look how his attitude towards God has sharpened. Verse 78, because of the kind of God we serve, because of the tender mercy of our God. So no matter what else you think of the God of the Old Testament, that's all Zechariah had to go on, was the Old Testament. And yet, what comes to Zechariah's mind is that God is a God of tender mercy. I wonder if we are reading our Bible right. I wonder if we are seeing what they saw, that they didn't deserve to be rescued from Egypt, and Zechariah surely didn't deserve to be standing here holding his own son when he should have been crushed for his unbelief. This says something about who God is and what he is like. And when you worship God, worship a God who is both just, and as we read this morning, is a justifier of the one who has faith in his son, Christ. Zechariah calls this event happening not the instant turning on of a light. Notice verse 78 there. He calls it a sunrise. A slow, steady, but sure rising of the sun. Some translations call it the day spring or the day star. It's not come up quickly and shining overhead in all of its noonday brightness. It is peeking up over the horizon and already casting its light rays and pushing away shadows and pointing the way, Zechariah says, pointing the way into the way of peace. So the imagery here is of a people wandering through the desert without a light. They're trying to make it home to the land that is promised to them, and they don't know the way. But while the sun is up, they're finding, they're tracking, and they lose their way, and now they lose the daylight. And on a night that is without moon and without stars, they cannot see their hands in front of their face, and they have lost their way. And notice what he says. Despair has so taken over them, verse 79, to give light to those who stop walking and now sit in darkness. The darkness feels so thick, so palpable, so hopeless that they've stopped even trying to find their way to peace. They just sit in the darkness. All of this is calling to mind the prophets. Malachi calling to mind Isaiah 9 that we read last Christmas, that those who sit in darkness have seen a great light. The darkness is called the shadow of death, not death itself, but right there in its shadows. And when the light just even peeks over the horizon, the black turning to purple and then turning to orange and then yellow, and you start to see the little glimmer of the ball of the sun peeking up over the horizon, the light that shoots out is already pointing the way to peace. So you might look at this gift of the horn of salvation, or this gift of the day star that is rising. He will come again in full brightness and will finally wrap up all these promises, but it's already started. And what God starts, he will finish. You may look at this and say, I just don't get it. I don't feel the need for it. It would be like somebody saying, Dean, for Christmas, here's a mousetrap. If you gave me a mousetrap last Christmas, I would say, thank you. If you gave me a mousetrap this Christmas, after discovering this huge hole in the side of the wall of my house, I would say, awesome, thank you. If someone said to me, Dean, after this service, I'm going to give you a ride to St. E's. We're going to get that taken care of. I would say, okay. I don't really want to go to St. E's. I've got other plans. Until I look down and see that my arm is bleeding and there's a huge gash in it. And of course, thank you for the ride to the hospital. You don't know the wonder of a gift until you realize your need for it. So you and I are a people who need forgiveness and leadership. Hear me. I don't care how long you've been a part of this church or how well you know your Bible. You and I are not past our need for forgiveness and leadership. We need Christ to come in His saving work and provide, verse 77, forgiveness of our sins. And we need Christ, the day star, to shine, and verse 79, provide guidance to our feet into the way of peace. We need forgiveness and leadership because ultimately the thing that God wants for us is freedom and peace. Freedom from the hound of hell nipping at our souls, and peace with God. And all of this is about God. All of this is for God. The reason we're given freedom, that we experience it in Christ, is not just to serve our own sinful tendencies, but to serve God without fear in holiness and righteousness all of our days. The reason we have peace with God is that we be restored to a right relationship with Him. And when you realize your need for forgiveness and leadership, bringing about freedom to serve God and peace with God, you can sing Zechariah's song of blessing to God as well. So would you stand and let me pray over you, and as we sing songs blessing His name. Lord, we thank You for Your word and for what You did in the lives of these people. We thank You for putting Zechariah through this time of discipline that he went through. We thank You for bringing him out by Your grace and into a song of redemption. And we thank You that You recorded it for our instruction. And so I'm asking, Lord, that the people gathered here would not receive this word with deaf ears, but would see that Christ, the horn, and Christ, the day star, has come, and You have visited Your people, and You are bringing about salvation, the ending of the night, the turning back of our rebellion, and the one day coming full brightness of our King. And so we ask that You would stir up in us a longing similar to what Old Testament Israel felt wanting the Messiah to come, and a wonder that You have included us by Your grace into this saving work. So as we sing, Holy Father, would You by Your Holy Spirit drive these things deeper into our soul? We ask in Christ's name. Amen. Let us reflect this wonder in song.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Amazing.
pray that you would have the boldness and the courage to believe Christ has forgiven you. May you go in his grace this week and live for his glory. You're dismissed.